This morning, Bryan Kohberger, the accused murderer of the brutal slaying of the Idaho University students Kaylee, Maddie, Ethan, and Zanna, had his arraignment hearing, sharply and promptly at 9 a.m. Pacific time.
What you do need to remember, though, is that anything you do say, other than to your lawyers, could be used against you in a later court proceeding. You understand that?
Yes, I do.
So today, I wanted to jump on here because we are going to be going over the arraignment and the details of what happened inside that courtroom, as well as review some of the footage from inside the courtroom as well. We also are going to be discussing the infamous Pappa Rodgers social media account. Now, you may remember a few months ago, I did a deep dive video on that account in which we go through the timeline, the posts, the discrepancies, everything. Well, with the recent Dateline episode that aired on Friday night, there is now a new heightened interest in Pappa Rodgers. And is that really Bryan? What that account really posted? Because they barely scratched the surface on Dateline regarding the account. So I'm going to include that portion of my original video from a few months back into this video to really illustrate the similarities or the coincidences between the two of them again. We've got a lot to talk about today, guys. My name is Annie Elise, this is 10 to Life, and let's jump right in.
This is 10 to Life with Annie Elise.
Bryan's arraignment hearing started promptly at 9 a.m. Pacific time today, Monday, May 22nd. Bryan walked into the courtroom alongside his attorney, Ann Taylor. He did the exact same look, nod, and face clench to Ann Taylor that he did the last time we saw him back in January. The new judge over the case is John Judge, so he read Bryan his rights, penalties, etc. Throughout the hearing, Bryan was attentive and looking straightforward at the judge, nodding a little bit as he listened to what the judge was saying. He said that he understood all of that and that he didn't have any questions. Then he was read all of the charges that were on the indictment, including the felony burglary charge alleging that on or about November 13th, 2022, he unlawfully entered the residence at King Road with that intent to commit murder. He also was read all of the murder charges for Kaylee, Ethan, Zanna, and Maddie. As the judge was reading the charges and saying each victim's name and cause of death, it was chilling. Bryan was also read the penalties for each charge and the maximums, which could be up to 10 years in addition to 4 consecutive life sentences or death, as well as fines for victims' restitutions of $200,000 and $20,000. Bryan said that he understood all of the charges and the maximum penalties.
Mr. Kohberger, do you understand the charge in count 1, burglary?
Yes.
Do you understand the maximum penalty?
Yes.
Do you understand the charge in count 2, murder in the first degree?
Yes.
Do you understand the maximum penalty?
Yes.
Do you understand the charge in count 3, murder in the first degree?
Yes.
Do you understand the maximum penalty?
Yes.
Do you understand the charge in count 4, murder in the first degree?
Yes.
Do you understand the maximum penalty?
Yes.
Do you understand the charge in count 5, murder in the first degree? Do you understand the maximum penalty?
Yes.
What you do need to remember, though, is that anything you do say, other than to your lawyers, could be used against you in a later court proceeding. You understand that?
Yes, I do.
Okay, thank you. You also have a right to appeal any final decision of the court. And in order to exercise that right, you need to file a notice of appeal within 42 days. You understand these rights?
Yes.
Any questions about the rights?
No.
All right.
When Ann Taylor was asked if Bryan Kohberger was prepared to enter a plea, she stood up and responded, "Your Honor, we will be standing silent," which kind of got everybody buzzing and talking on social media, of course, because they were expecting him to enter a not guilty plea specifically. But apparently this is pretty common. From what I've gathered online, it is legally referred to as standing silent or standing mute. According to a legal website that I found, and I will link the source in the description box, in the context of criminal proceedings, standing mute most commonly refers to a defendant's refusal to enter a plea when asked to do so by the court. When a defendant is arraigned, they of course are informed of the charges against them and asked to enter a plea of guilty or not guilty. If the defendant refuses to enter a plea, the court will typically enter a not guilty plea on their behalf. This is known as a stand mute plea because the defendant is effectively refusing to speak and declining to make a plea. There are a number of reasons why a defendant may choose to stand mute. In some cases, they may be attempting to delay the proceedings or hoping to negotiate a plea agreement with the prosecution. In other cases, they may be protesting the legitimacy of the court or the charges against them. Regardless of the defendant's reasons for standing mute, the court will still proceed with the trial as if the defendant had entered a not guilty plea. And that is exactly what happened in today's hearing with Bryan Kohberger. Because of him choosing to stand mute, the judge entered the plea of not guilty for charges on Bryan's behalf. This means that the prosecution will need to present evidence to prove the defendant's guilt beyond a reasonable doubt, and the defendant will have the opportunity to mount a defense and present evidence on their own behalf as well. Standing mute can have significant consequences for a defendant's case. If the defendant is convicted, the judge may take their refusal to enter a plea into account when deciding on an appropriate sentence. Additionally, a defendant who stands mute may be viewed with suspicion by the jury, who may interpret their silence as an admission of guilt. In some cases, defendants may choose to do this as a form of protest against what they see as an unjust legal system. For example, in 1968, the Chicago Eight, a group of anti-war protesters, stood mute during their trial in protest of what they saw as an unfair trial process. This tactic can be risky, however, as it may lead to increased hostility from the court and jury and may not have the desired impact on public opinion. Ann Taylor asked the court to set the trial right outside of the speedy trial window, saying that they aren't prepared to do anything at the moment. The prosecution said that the trial dates will work for the state, and the trial is officially scheduled to begin October 2nd, 2023 at 8:30 a.m. So now that we know what happened after this arraignment, which was again something that kind of was blitzed on everybody, where we thought that the next move for Bryan Kohberger was going to be his preliminary hearing in June, we now wait. We wait and see if this trial will be pushed out, if it will actually begin October 2nd as scheduled, to be determined on that. But now let's shift gears a little bit and go back into the Pappa Rodgers video, where we go through all of the details between the two, the similarities, and you make the decision if you believe Bryan Kohberger is also the account holder of the Pappa Rodgers account. So first, before we go any further, I want to take you through that 3D simulation that was sent to me. It's a great animation that depicts what happened that night. I did not create this video, though. It was created by an account called AZ Get Industries, which I will link in the description. I wanted to show you this visual, not only because so many of you have been requesting my take on it, but also because it really sets the tone for what we're going to be discussing next. However, there were a couple of timestamps that weren't 100% accurate according to the affidavit and to some of the timestamps that we had backed into a little bit, so I did some editing to make them more in line with the affidavit. So to start in this visual, it's really just a 3D version of the house. It walks you through room by room, showing you the different levels of the house, where the rooms are laid out, how the floor plan is structured, and just so you can really get an idea of how the house layout is. Because we know there has been so much confusion since the very beginning of this case with it being a tri-level home. What's the first floor? What's the second floor? What's the third floor? Where are all of the rooms? So this really just goes through and illustrates that for you. Then it takes you into what looks almost like a dollhouse 3D rendering of the home, where all of the roommates were in the house and where the dog was in the house, and then the movements of the killer, allegedly Bryan. So what I'm going to do is also put up a timeline on the left-hand side of the screen. This way it will take you through the movements of this killer in the house as well as the timeline. Now, I want to be clear, the timeline, any timestamp that is in black is what has been confirmed by the affidavit. Anything in red is what my guesstimate is of a time range or time marker of what took place and when, not only according to the confirmed times in the affidavit, but also in line with certain things we've been given and evidence and things that we have seen out there. So just letting you know, anything in red is my guesstimate of the time. The black is what's confirmed in the affidavit. So as we look at this rendering in this house, we know that at 4 a.m., Zanna receives her DoorDash delivery. We also know, according to the affidavit, that at 4:04 a.m., that white Elantra parks at 500 Queen Road. Now, what's interesting about this is that when you look at Queen Road on a map and where this vehicle parked, if you put in the King Road residence address as well, it says it's about a 1 minute drive from point A to B. However, that's going around the long route. If you look at it and you look walking distance, it is probably a 1 minute walk or less if you're speed walking or running. So to me, if he parked at 4:04 a.m., my guesstimate is that entry to the home was at approximately 4:06 a.m. That takes into account the time walking from the vehicle to the house and then entering the home. Based on the timeline in the affidavit, we know that this killer went upstairs first and took those two victims first. It wouldn't really make sense any other way. Now, the roommate DM says in the affidavit that shortly after 4 a.m., she hears Murphy, the dog, upstairs in Kaylee's room, and that she thinks she hears Kaylee playing with him. So I believe that when the roommate heard Murphy upstairs, it wasn't Kaylee playing with the dog, but that it was actually the killer going into Kaylee's room first, looking for her. And then realizing that she was not in the room. And the dog, of course, was in that room. So either the dog jumped off the bed, maybe then the killer was shutting the door to keep the dog inside so that it wouldn't interfere in his plans. And then he goes across the hall into Maddie's room. In the affidavit, DM says that she hears somebody say, "Someone is here," shortly after, and that that's when she opens her door for the first time. It's my belief that when the killer closed the door behind Murphy and was approaching Maddie's room, that's when one of the girls heard somebody and said, "Somebody is here." And so Dylan hears that and opens her door for the first time, not knowing that the brutal murders are occurring right above her head. And I put this as an estimated time around 4:08 to 4:09, again, just kind of going minute by minute from that entry point of 4:06 a.m. This would put the window in which Kaylee and Maddie are killed between 4:08 and 4:12 a.m. as my guesstimate. Again, not confirmed by law enforcement, but when you look at the total timeline from start to finish and when the white Elantra is seen leaving, this is kind of how all of these time markers slice out. And also, I just want to mention, so many people have been saying, how could somebody kill four people in 16 minutes or less? Because this actually kind of narrows it down to closer to 12 minutes. It's not hard to do. We have seen in so many cases, especially when it's stabbing that takes place, that it happens very quickly. And I just want to kind of paint the picture for you. If it was 12 minutes on the short side, 16 minutes on the long side of when all of these murders took place, that averages to just a few minutes for each victim, specifically 3 to 4 minutes per victim. Now, if I hold this pillow, and Mike King did a great exercise actually of like the force that it takes and how tired you would get once the blade dulls, but if I were to take this pillow and I were to put a timer on for just 60 seconds where I'm going like this over and over and over, that would feel like a very long time. So if you start to think 3 to 4 minutes per person of just going like this or slicing or doing whatever you're doing, that is very quick. It does not take long to kill somebody. As we continue, Bryan leaves the girls' room, and we next know, according to the affidavit, that at 4:12 a.m., Zanna's TikTok is active. We don't know if she was actively scrolling or if the app was open and then she was ambushed and the phone dropped and it was still running at 4:12, but we know that it was active at 4:12. Now, in this rendering, and again, because this isn't my own video, even though I've made some edits, I wasn't able to actually move the killer's silhouette anywhere. It has him placed in the hallway. On my previous video, when I also showed my suggested outline, I said that I believe that this killer potentially ran into Zanna or Ethan in the hallway, maybe when Zanna was taking her DoorDash back to the kitchen, maybe when she was scrolling on TikTok and just walking around, and that I thought that something happened in the hallway rather than the bedrooms. This is just my opinion, but I thought this because The roommate, DM, says that she hears crying and she hears a male voice say, "It's okay, I'm going to help you," which it's my opinion that she would only be able to hear that so clearly if it was happening right outside of her bedroom, not all the way down the hall and around the corner in Xana's room. So I wasn't able to put any silhouettes in here of, you know, Xana or Ethan next to the killer. It's just him walking through the hallway. But I did put at that estimated time between 4:12 when Xana was last active on TikTok and 4:14 that she heard crying and the male voice say, "It's okay, I'm going to help you." And that's also when she opens her door for a second time. Now, the reason I put that time marker is after Xana being active on TikTok is because I don't believe Xana would be crying and then go over and start swiping on TikTok. So it would have happened after that. So I put this at 4:12 to 4:14 a.m. By the time Dylan then opens her bedroom door after hearing this, I believe that they're already in Xana's bedroom. Then we know that Xana and Ethan are killed. And I put this time as between 4:12 a.m. and 4:17 a.m. I put 4:12, although I do think that the murders took place a couple of minutes later, perhaps at 4:14, perhaps 4:13 at the earliest after her TikTok went, you know, dead or her phone fell or whatever may have happened. But I put through 4:17 because we know that according to the affidavit, the neighbor's audio picked up whimpering, a dog barking, and a very loud thud at 4:17 a.m. So I believe this was the final strike and final blow from Bryan to these two young people. Then in the affidavit, DM says she opens her door for a third time, and that's when she sees the male dressed in black walking towards her and out the kitchen. But in the affidavit, she never explains why she opened her door that third time. She just says that she opened it and that she sees this person walking towards her, allegedly Bryan. So I believe that she opened her door at 4:17 when that loud thud happened. I think that is what prompted her to open the door. And I also think that's what prompted Bryan, or the killer, to leave right then. Because it was loud, the dog was barking, there was a thud, and I believe that's when he started to book it out of there, and that's what prompted Dylan to once again be like, "What the heck is going on?" and open her door, and then she comes face to face with Bryan. Or not face to face, but she sees him. So then Brian's walking out, and I don't know if Bryan actually ever even saw Dylan, because if she just cracked her door open, it's very possible that he was just beelining it for the sliding glass door and didn't even know that she was in there. So he then goes out the sliding glass door, which I'm putting at about, you know, probably 4:17 to 4:18. And then we know the next movements are that at 4:20, the white Elantra speeds away from that 500 Queen Road parking area. Which again, if we're talking walking distance and saying it takes a minute to walk from the car to the home, especially if he was then walking back and had to take off any bloody clothing and put it in his trunk or do whatever he was doing, if he left at 4:17, the walk to the car, 4:18, maybe dump the clothes for a second, 30 seconds, maybe 60 seconds, then speeds off from Queens Road at 4:20 a.m. I hope this visual aid was helpful. It was definitely helpful for me when I was like looking at the outline and seeing what really actually probably took place. And it's really scary and unsettling watching that visual aid. But again, so many of you guys have been messaging me and requesting my take on it and sharing it with me that I wanted to just share it with you, but also make a couple of tweaks because again, there were a couple little tiny bits that I felt like were inaccurate. Now let's move on to the next big topic. There has been a ton of speculation about certain user profiles in one of the many online case discussion groups for the Idaho murders on Facebook. Pappa Rodgers, the user on Facebook that has coincidentally vanished after Bryan Kohberger's arrest, has been debated online in depth about whether this person had inside knowledge or was actually Bryan himself. I've seen your comments and emails telling me to look into this. And I saw a few posts that were at first just a little eerie here and there, but could be anyone or just randomly ironic. And I didn't really have an opinion either way. Plus, it's common for people that committed a crime to insert themselves into case discussion groups afterwards. So I didn't really think it mattered, since even if it was allegedly Bryan, he was already in custody. However, since the release of the arrest warrant on January 5th, I've gone back and looked at previous posts, as many people have, and I can't deny that it certainly looks like it could have been him, as well as some posts that make me feel like it isn't him at all. So for now, I'm just going to discuss the most relevant posts that I've seen. And I know there are a lot of screenshots floating around. It's a huge rabbit hole, guys. A ton of different opinions on many different user profiles across several platforms with hundreds of posts. So not going down that one today, but I mean, if you feel like you want to take hours on end of your day to go down it, there is a lot of content to consume. So as you're watching, if I miss something or you disagree, feel free to comment and let me know your thoughts, because this is a little bit crazy. As always, this is all alleged and just my take on things. But I want to be clear, this is 100% my speculation and my opinions. Other than the arrest warrant, none of the posts should be taken as facts of the case or 100% linked to anybody. Now, I'm going to go a little bit out of order chronologically, since some posts are hard to see when the post or comment was made. Some of them have dates, but some screenshots I found online say something like 24 days ago, for example. So since we don't really know when that screenshot was taken, we really have no clue when the post originated. So on December 11th, Pappa Rodgers asks, "How long do we think that the killer was in the house?" Okay, could be nothing. And then a few days later, somebody replies and asks, "How long do you think?" And Pappa Rodgers replies back very matter of fact and says 15 minutes. Now guys, when you look at the affidavit and look at this highlighted portion, it says this leads investigators to believe the homicides occurred between 4 a.m. and 4:25 a.m. That's obviously a 25-minute window and not a 15-minute window. However, when we know now that the car parked at 4:04 and left at 4:20, that's a 16-minute window. That is very in line with 15 minutes. I mean, that is pretty specific. I don't know that if I took a wild guess of how long the killer was inside, I would have guessed 15 minutes. I probably would have guessed a bit longer. But the fact that this person said 15 minutes and that that was like a minute shy of what was on surveillance kind of hit it right on the money. And it's not the only time he did, which we're going to get to all of that in a second. So I never would have thought that it would have been that quickly. And I think a lot of us are even still grappling with that timeline now, which is why I did that illustration earlier of how long 60 seconds of stabbing somebody really is. But maybe some people would just guess that. I don't know. But based on when his car was seen parking at 4:04 to speeding away as he left the scene at 4:20, again, it's just 16 minutes, not even including the walking time between the car, the house, and back. But just based on this post alone, it could be anyone. It doesn't mean that Bryan owns this account. Then on December 20th, Pappa Rodgers asks, "Did the killer drive, walk, or some combination of both to the scene?" This question isn't the same, but it is very similar to a question that is from the survey that was posted on Reddit that is verified to be Bryan's. This survey question said, "Before making your move, how did you approach the victim or target? Please detail what you were thinking and feeling." Again, it could be another coincidence altogether, and if we had never seen that survey, I don't know that anybody would have become suspicious of the similarities in the questions. But another thing in the comments is that Pappa Rodgers predicts that the killer lives alone, which at this point, it's been said that Bryan did live alone. Also, in Bryan's survey, he wanted to know if they took anything from the scene, and so did Pappa Rodger, which a lot of us did, to be fair, and we don't know if the killer did take anything from the scene. We're not sure, right? We could possibly find out after the search warrant is unsealed. I believe that there are trophies in the house, and I believe that that's why the warrant for his apartment search is sealed, because it says an effort to protect the witnesses, the victims, the families. I think that they probably found something in that apartment and they're not releasing it yet, but that's just my opinion. And Pappa Rodger also says he thinks something was taken. So it will be interesting to see if that turns out to be true or not. One of the things that made everybody notice the Pappa Rodgers account was all of the similarities to Bryan's survey questions, which is pretty understandable, but isn't proof. One thing I noticed is that Pappa Rodgers' account asked way more questions than made posts of his own theory or opinion. I know that there are some posts where he just posted statements, but I'm meaning overall. And this got me thinking about something, which I will get into in a second. But specifically, this post really stood out to me. In this post, the poster is asking what possible motives could be, such as a robbery target because the door was accessible, he had grudges, a house full of girls, all sorts of different things, and also asking what the situation could be. And you can see his response, excellent. So this got me thinking, why is this account asking all these questions? Is it just someone being legitimately curious of what people think? Or if this was allegedly Bryan, why would he be asking questions that he would know the answer to? There are a few reasons I could think of, but with this post and his response, the whole excellent thing made me feel kind of weird. Like I was reading a doting professor when a student finally gets an answer right that nobody in the class has been able to come up with, which I know is a stretch, but hear me out for a second. Professors high up in the academia ladder sometimes teach their students using the Socratic method. The Socratic method was named after the Greek philosopher Socrates. Basically, the method is a dialogue between the teacher and the students, where the teacher continually asks the students questions in a way that the students come to the answer that the professor is looking for in their own way. I'm definitely not trying to minimize the Socratic method to a Facebook discussion group at all here, guys, and I could totally be wrong, but I just want to see if anybody else noticed that. And I think this is one of the very few posts where Papa Roger made a comment like that, almost as though he's been asking these questions, trying to see what people will come up with to see if they have the right answer. It's very bizarre. On this post, there were people debating on what windows went into each room of the house. Papa Roger seemed to know the answer. And this too could be someone who had studied the layout 100%. It's just odd now having read the arrest warrant and knowing that allegedly Bryan had been watching the house on so many occasions. Especially given that there was so much confusion about the layout of the house when this initially first all broke, but he seemed to know it flawlessly. Some of the more oddly specific posts, Papa Roger not only seems adamant, at least to me, that this was a sexually motivated crime, but he also asks if anyone thinks the killer has some type of sexual dysfunction. Maybe this post was just brainstorming, throwing something out there, I don't know. And we also don't know what any of the motivation was in all of this, so we truly have no idea. I just found this a little bit odd. In the Facebook discussion groups, for the most part, people get pretty heated if they think somebody is asking a stupid question or misstating facts, things like that. And for the most part, people seem to understand that their theory isn't any more credible than others, and they usually say that. To be fair, though, Papa Rogers did say MIO, meaning in my opinion, on some of the posts, but I found this exchange very interesting. He asks if the killer had a sexual dysfunction, and then somebody comments, yeah, he also likes a steak medium, and he writes, you know, is that your first thought? But as it continues, somebody comments, why on earth would the police state otherwise if it truly was a sexually motivated crime? This was out and out murder. And he goes on to push back, saying police have never stated a motive, which is true. They continue saying that there was no sexual aspect here. So then he probes them, okay, well then what is the motive? The person responds saying, I have no idea, and he just says, motive. So they ask him to expand on that and why the police would be lying about that aspect. And then he says, don't believe there is another motive. He then makes a post that says, regardless of what has been released, I believe this is a sexually motivated crime. Again, it could just be somebody's strong opinion. It's just very odd when you kind of couple everything together. Some other interesting posts that the Papa Roger account made were some with, knowing what we know now, if this was allegedly Bryan, could be seen as things that he possibly posted to throw law enforcement off. I'm not sure. He talks a lot about the police not having evidence, the case possibly going cold if there aren't any arrests made soon, and on two different posts, he said that the white Elantra wasn't related and that it could be a red herring. Which, rather than being a red herring, I think he could have been making these posts about the white car being irrelevant because it was the one thing that was relevant in all of this, aside from his DNA. And maybe he was trying to throw people off and make them think that it really didn't matter, so they would stop sharing the flyer and they would stop inquiring about it. Because everything else, he seemed to know everything, and now he's saying this is irrelevant. Why? Because it was, obviously, relevant. Now, we've been talking a lot about this for a while, about who was the intended target. We believe, most people, that it was Kaylee or Maddie. I believe it was Kaylee, as do others. But we've been talking about how Ethan, most likely, was not a target in all of this, and that he was, unfortunately, there because he was with Xana, and he was an unfortunate casualty along the way. Now, these conversations are pretty interesting. In this Papa Roger post, Ethan didn't live at the crime scene. Was possible that the killer didn't know he was there. Thoughts? Again, almost as though he's probing to get the right answer out of his students or these posters, because then take a look at this. Somebody comments, I'm assuming that the killer knew Ethan would be there and knew he had to attack him first as he would put up the most fight. Papa Rogers responds, why do you think that he put up the biggest fight? Where did you get that? And they say, I never said he did put up the most fight. We don't really know anything about their defensive wounds besides Xana's dad confirming that she had them. But it's interesting because it's almost like in an underlying way he's trying to challenge that, saying, who says he put up a fight? Who said he put up the worst fight? Which again, nobody did, but it just feels phrased odd. And tell me what you guys think. The Papa Rogers guy also knew the exact route that the killer took before police provided any details about where the Elantra parked in that affidavit. If you look at these photos here, from early December, He posts, "This is the high side of the house. They found evidence here. It's likely blood dripping from the killer or killers, plural. Either they fled through this area or they were parked there. This being the most strategic entrance point to the house, it shows planning." He then also posts, "I believe the killer came from the high side of the house. They were covered in blood after the attack." Now, this post probably holds the most water for me. How on earth did this account know that the killer left a sheath behind? Maybe Papa Roger needs to go buy a lottery ticket or something, because this, on top of everything else, was the tipping point in who I think could be behind this account. And I'm not the only one. In this thread, the user gets in a tussle with another user about the sheath, and some of the replies are literally exactly what we are all thinking now since we know that the sheath was found. So it's pretty incredible that so many people were catching on to this way back then. Here is the post and the replies. "Of the evidence released, the murder weapon has been consistent as a large fixed blade knife. This leads me to believe that they found the sheath. This evidence was released prior to the autopsies." Somebody responds saying, "Someone who is about ready to commit a premeditated murder, if you were sneaking into somebody's house looking to kill them with a knife, would you have a knife in a sheath when you entered? I think the killer had it in his hand upon entering just in case he was confronted and forced to fight." He responds challenging him saying, "How did the killer hold the knife prior to entering the scene then, in your opinion?" He says, "I guess he would have carried it in his hand from wherever he came from." There's another comment saying, "Who knows, finding a left behind sheath seems like a stretch though." Again, he challenges back, asking why. They are very specific about the weapon, but very vague about every other detail. They comment back, "I think it's more likely that they did closer examination on the wounds on the scene than you think. They can analyze depth of the wound, width, serrated edge, and serrated edge would be a big clue. I'm sure they have access to a database that would show knives that match those dimensions. Plus, I've never seen a folding knife that has a serrated edge." He pushes back once more. "They don't clean bodies at a crime scene. The amount of blood must have been tremendous." It goes back and forth for quite some time, which I'll put the screenshots up here on the page, and you can pause if you want to read it. But then at one point, this commenter says, "Because who would carry a sheath?" And then he again responds and says, "Who would carry a large exposed knife?" And they continue to argue back and forth until finally, this commenter says, "Why do you communicate like a serial killer?" It's very, very odd because he becomes combative for anybody who challenges his theories or challenges his answers when this is a case discussion group. And a lot of people do get like that, don't get me wrong, in these groups. But he says things so matter-of-factly and in such a way, and then gets almost angry when you push back on that, to where he pushes back as though he needs to be the smartest person in the room, which we have heard from classmates, friends, students, all of these things, that is kind of in line with Brian's MO, that he always has to be the smartest guy in the room, which again just kind of makes this feel a little bit too close for comfort. Now, since January 5th, which was long after this post was written, we of course know that a sheath was found. So here's my question. Did law enforcement notice this post? And is that why this Facebook account is gone? And if it was investigated, and let's just pretend that these posts were allegedly made by Bryan, can you imagine the amount of data that they were able to extract off his computer? There were also a couple of posts that either the Papa Rogers account got completely wrong, according to the affidavit, or maybe he made trying to cast more doubt on himself, because towards the end of his posting activity, before the account vanished and disappeared, some of the people in the group were starting to get a little suspicious of him. So he started posting things such as, "I can't begin to have the mindset of a killer." Also a post guessing where the bodies were found, which we know is now wrong. Little things like that. Almost as though he was so confident this whole time of, this is the right answer. This is how it happened. This was the weapon. This was the evidence left behind. But now getting all of these breadcrumbs along the way and even saying, "But I don't know. It's just my guess. I can't even pretend to have the mind of a killer." Feels like too many people were starting to look at him. Now, in addition to that account, another account that I think may have some insight is the Inside Looking Reddit account. For the record, I think that the Papa Roger account makes much more sense than this one does, but there are some peculiar similarities in terms of the writing style and the responses given, and I want to see if you guys pick up on any. So comment below with the timestamp when you think it feels like the author could also be Papa Roger, just based on what was said, and let me know why. In this first post, somebody says how they believe that the killer was laying in wait and that it was after either the first roommates got home and in bed or before any of them got home, talking about how it's it's risky to leave, that he needed to control the situation, that he would have been able to scope the house out, all of these things. This person writes back very matter-of-factly saying, no, the killer was outside before the murders, in my opinion. This person uses the IMO, just like Pappa Rodgers' account did. They are very short, just like the Pappa Rodgers account was, and also very matter-of-fact, like the Pappa Rodgers account was. We also know that the killer was outside for a while up until the entry to the home, that he was driving around, that he circled the house, what was it, three times, and then was waiting. Makes sense, ties together. Then this account posts, why are the outside handles different? Somebody replies saying, I don't know what you mean, I don't know where you live, but the locks outside my door are more secure than the locks on internal doors, all this stuff. This person replies saying, would this mean the entry was to the slider? Perp didn't close it when he entered, so he just took it off while it was still open? No marks on the inside handle then. Then in this post, it says, let's talk about after the murders. And this person is asking about the theories about the murders leading up to it, during the murders, how the killer exited, then what the killer's mood and activities were immediately following the murders, if they went back home and if they had been following it on the media, all these things. And this person just responds with rush of adrenaline, very excited. Again, very matter of fact and brief. In this one, it's talking about who was the target and talking about Maddie and Xana. And then he responds saying likely Xana and Maddie were targets. Same work, same sorority, same house, same majors, different floors. Which is possible that they were the targets because we, again, don't know for certain. Or this could have been to, I don't know, maybe throw people off. Who knows? In this next post, it's titled Multiple Suspects for Multiple Victims with a question mark. And it's talking about, was there one or could there have been multiple? And this account, again, inside looking, replies, speculation, one killer. Very matter of fact and cold. Then in a post, this person actually says what they believe the details were, saying that the killer enters the sliding door and exits the sliding door. That if Kaylee, Maddie were the targets, the path doesn't cross Ethan and Xana. And if Ethan and Xana were the targets, the path doesn't cross Kaylee and Maddie. Ethan and Kaylee didn't reside at the home. Therefore, Xana and Maddie must have been the targets. Now, this is kind of where I have a little bit of a issue with this, because I do, again, believe that Kaylee was the target because I believe that he went into Kaylee's room first looking for her, and that's where Murphy was, and then went into Maddie's room and found both girls. So I don't know, but sharing with you anyway, because it has been a big point of discussion out there. Then this inside looking account posts speculation. Killer went to the kitchen, then to Ethan and Xana's room, then to Maddie and Kaylee's room. And then people are responding saying, where's your source? Why do you think that? And he says, don't bite the hand that feeds you. You get nothing. So again, I feel like the Pappa Rodgers account definitely felt like they had the answers more and it was a little bit more eerie. But these are very similar. And it could just be this account trying to cast doubt. I don't know. Because again, based on the timeline that we know, it could be possible. But I don't believe that Xana and Ethan were killed first. Somebody then posted that the door being open was a huge red flag for them because it would alert anyone that saw it from either inside the house or outside the house that something was wrong, where inside looking replies saying everyone was asleep, it's better to leave it open to make it easier for an escape, which is true, and I guess anybody could come to that conclusion. Then they make a post saying everyone is capable of murder. Being convicted of murder is a separate thing. Now, I find this post very interesting because one of the topics that everybody has been discussing is motive, right? And did Bryan do this to prove simply that he was smarter than law enforcement, smarter than the system, and that he could get away with it based on his areas of study, based on wanting to also work with law enforcement and intern with them, all of these things, and that that was the motive. So by this person saying everybody is capable of it, but being convicted of it is another thing, is a pretty interesting statement to say. True, 100%, very, very true. Not that everybody's capable of it. I mean, I guess I suppose, but true that being convicted is an entirely separate thing. But again, just odd. Then in another post, somebody's asking the progress of the case, when they believe an arrest will be made. And inside looking says, no arrest before Christmas. This case goes cold, in my opinion. And he says the reason is because TikTokers and Redditors are sending in bogus tips. Then in another interesting post, and it says 3 days, so I don't know exactly when this was and if it was, in fact, when Bryan left for Pennsylvania, but this person says, being on the run is not fun in my opinion. Again, the abbreviation of IMO, not many people use that, some do, but Pappa Rodgers did. Then in a post, somebody saying, I'm convinced this crime was committed by somebody else. Inside looking says, he's not involved. And this person challenges him, saying, "You're incorrect." Responds, "I am correct. No, I promise that you're incorrect. I promise you that you are incorrect." Just again, getting combative as though their response and their opinion is the only valid one. And it's just very cut, cold, matter-of-fact statements. In another post, this account posts speculation, tire marks are from the killer's car when they fled the scene from behind the house. Which again, nobody at this point knew that the car had been parked behind the house or that they fled the scene at a high speed, which we know from the affidavit was true. Then somebody said that the killer entered and left via the rear of the house and used the hill to walk to park to the car on Walenta Street, saying that that's where he would have parked if he had used a car and he would have walked home if he stayed locally, and saying how where the police activity was. This person simply replies, "Wrong. The killer was in the parking lot behind the house and drove off from there," again, in my opinion. This post is the most convincing to me because of the way it is written. It seems like it's being stated as fact, and I want to know how anybody could have specifically known all of this. Or maybe it was a lucky guess. I don't know. But Pappa Rodgers also said the same thing over Facebook. So whoever this account is correctly predicted where the killer parked and what the tire marks were showing when it wasn't public knowledge that the killer sped off from the scene and predicted the direction that the scene was left, even going as far as to mention Walenta Street. Again, maybe just a lucky guess, but I don't know. And again, this post, along with the other ones I just went over, is just crazy. Could be explained away, but what do we always say? Where there's smoke, there's fire. And at what point can you stop explaining away so many coincidences? Now let's talk about the elephant in the room here. The name of the Facebook account alone, Pappa Rodgers. What a weird name, right? And I'm assuming that he wasn't referencing Mr. Rodgers in the neighborhood, mostly because they are very different last names, but also because Mr. Rodgers was everybody's like favorite friendly neighbor. But another person that my mind immediately shot to was Elliot Rodgers. Now, I messaged this actually to one of my girls in the Discord and researchers on my team about, gosh, I think it was a week and a half ago now. And I said, wait a minute, as this whole Pappa Rodgers thing was stirring, I was like, hold on. Is he saying Pappa Rodgers like he's looking to Elliot Rodgers as like his father figure, his dad, his, you know, whatever you would say, like influencer, things like that? Is that what this is about? And it's so funny because, again, when I spit out my water watching Banfield last night, they literally said the exact same thing. And this video has been like in the works for several days now. I'm like, has she hacked my phone? How does she know what we're talking about? But it appears I'm not the only one thinking this. Now, if you're like, hey, shut up, Annie, who the hell is Elliot Rodgers? Let me tell you, he was a 22-year-old guy who murdered 6 people and injured over a dozen before taking his own life back in 2014. And his motive was simple. He was a misogynist who hated women and was frustrated by the lack of action in his own dating life. He was the original incel who incited an incel rebellion. Again, for those who don't know what incel means, I believe it's an abbreviation for involuntarily celibate. Basically, people who can't get any action. So, with that, incels are a group of men who are involuntarily celibate because they believe, and I'm paraphrasing here, that the feminist movement and women empowerment ideology throughout the past few decades has now harmed men. That nowadays women have more choices and are more selective in their male suitors. And that this is obviously why none of the incels have ever had a chance to date. Because of all of the choices and decision-making abilities women have now, that they take men for granted and only like certain men, and that women don't want to be with men who aren't doing anything with their lives or have lack of ambition, and this is a serious problem to them. So these men have collectively decided to completely withdraw themselves from society and the dating world. Incels are what is described as distraught with their lack of sexual experiences and often expressing their disappointment as anger towards women. And it's women's fault that incels haven't been successful in any of their dating hookups or endeavors, which is just beyond ridiculous. Sorry, incels, it is. It's ridiculous. I probably shouldn't say that because that community is actually a little bit scary. But anyways, I am being dead serious. This is actually a fringe social group that has a very active community online. And it's not small at all. It's a lot bigger than you would think. But that is definitely a topic for another day. So why would Pappa Rodgers be connected to Elliot Rodgers? Or why are people making this inference at all? Well, whenever Elliot Rodgers decided to express his rage and frustration with why women didn't like him and killed 6 people and injured a ton of other people, he was considered a hero in the incel community. And there have been a few like-minded murderers who either took themselves out or are now arrested. Many incels have regarded Elliot Rodger as their idol, or, as many incels call him, the supreme gentleman.
Anywhere anymore without seeing these young couples getting jealous and, you know, having them remind me of what I'm lacking in life.
I'll link this video below for anybody who's interested. There are a lot of videos about who Elliot Rodger was and his ideas before he flew into his murderous rage, and even creepier, he actually wrote a manifesto before he carried out his big plan. I wonder if we're going to find any sort of manifesto on good old Bry Boy's computer. So for a while now, a lot of people have suspected that the person responsible for the senseless and tragic deaths of Ethan, Zanna, Maddie, and Kaylee was an incel, like Elliot Rodgers. So was the killer Pappa Rodger? If so, does the name Pappa Rodger have any connection to someone who thinks Elliot Rodger is someone to look up to, and maybe somebody jokingly calling him Papa? I don't know. Maybe it's a coincidence. I think there are a lot of angles to be looked at as far as who the killer is, and incel is definitely one I've been thinking about for quite some time. But I don't believe that this is the only factor that could have played a role in the murders. But Rodgers, the last name, usually is spelled more commonly without the D. So the fact that these were both spelled with a D, I don't know. It's just, again, too close for comfort. Interestingly, there is also an online campaign that is said to have been created by incels, and it's a campaign to free Bryan Kohberger. Looking at the arrest warrant and only the facts we know, it is pretty eerie how similar and how much information both of these accounts were correct about, but it's not definitive proof, so we can only guess. If this was in fact Bryan Kohberger, which we don't know, but if it is, that would be pretty damning evidence. And for what? To freak people out in these discussion groups, to gloat about your crime and how knowledgeable you are, to be praised for guessing the crime scene and aspects about it after the facts were made public? Was it to toy with law enforcement? Because if you think about it, it's almost for this exact reason that the police don't release all of the facts during the beginning of investigations. To catch people saying things and people who know more about the crime scene or details that only the perpetrator would know. And I want to bring up the Socratic method one more time and the way that this person was communicating their opinions, stating things, almost trying to pull out the answer from his students or from the case discussion group. And it kind of plays into the theory that maybe he was even trying to teach a class about this case in the future and see what people knew and see what information he could garner. I don't know. It's very bizarre. What do you guys make of all of that? Do you think that it's somebody else who owns this account and it's purely coincidence? Or do you think this is somewhat of a smoking gun in terms of this being Bryan Kohberger and having information well before the police ever released it to the public? It'll be interesting to see, with all of the tech that they had seized from Bryan, if any of it links back to those accounts. I'm going to keep you guys updated as we continue to follow this case very closely. As a reminder, if you don't follow along on the channel yet, please make sure you do so by hitting subscribe. But also, I have a new podcast called Serialously, and I'm able to drop faster updates over there because I don't have to go through the YouTube approval process. For example, last week when we first heard that Bryan was indicted, I was able to drop a bonus episode on there within minutes, and it was audio only. So you can get it wherever you get your podcasts. The name of that, again, is Serialously. So make sure you're checking that out as well, as I'm able to get updates out there quicker. And we, of course, have our regular episodes releasing every single Monday. All right, guys, thanks so much for tuning in with me today. And until the next one, stay safe. Bye.